Hey swingers, welcome to week two of our online learning. Thanks for turning in your fact sheets. I've received a few blank forms. Make sure that you are downloading these PDFs. PDFs are universal computer language, so make sure you learn how to do this on your computer. This is good practice for college when you have to do things online. I have opened up a new content area in your class called Online Learning Resources, which has instructions on how to use Blackboard, instructions how to download PDFs, and then save them. Also, if you can't download them, to be able to print them as PDFs. So please, keep trying, look at all the options that you have, keep working, and if one thing doesn't work, try something else. You should be able to figure this out. Once again, these PDFs should be pretty universal. I'm also this week's assignment could be done PDF or Word file, so that might be easier for some of you too, but make sure you're downloading the Blackboard, read the instructions, get all the helpful hints. But now, let's get on to the jazz. So we're going to spend this time working on jazz history. So we're going to go right from the beginning of jazz, where it came from, and we'll see how far we get. So today we're going to start right where it started from. We've got a little introductory video for you to watch. Please enjoy.
You can even dance to it. It's jazz, and it's as full of soul and promise as the great country that gave birth to it. Jazz is all about democracy, individuals coming together, exchanging traditions, and adopting new ideas to create new harmonies and new expressions of freedom like the world it never heard before. Jazz is more than America's music. Jazz is America.
I don't think it's possible to study social history in the United States without recognizing jazz as one of the central phenomena.
Jazz is an absolutely critical part of American history. It's actually, obviously it's an art form that was created here in the United States, and I think that it's an art form that could have only been created here in the United States.
This is music that came up out of a necessity for survival. And so it speaks about humanity in a very deep way. Some of the things that are most beautiful come out of some of the most horrible things.
Jazz grew out of the African-American community at the turn of the 20th century, a time when blacks were being denied their most basic rights.
So in the case of the Afro-American, of course, it's natural that they would bring the American message that would be objectified in an art form because they were the ones who were denied freedom the most. When you were treated unjust, when you're treated with that level of degradation and you're abused to that level, your concept of freedom would be much greater. It's like to a blind person, seeing is something much more magnificent than a person who can see.
People from everywhere came and went to New Orleans, bringing in their own styles of music, from Midwestern ragtime and parading funeral bands the European opera and the African drums heard every Sunday in Congo Square. All the ingredients of jazz met and mixed in the streets of New Orleans.
When you think back to the early 1850s in New Orleans, when you had this sort of mixing of all these different cultures of people from the West Indies, and you had people from Italy and from all across Europe, all coming together in this one space, of course, with people of African descent as well. All these different cultures living in close proximity. It's really an early form of integration, though they weren't, you know, buddy-buddy.
So now you have this one city. It was founded by the French. It was developed by the Spanish. It's an American city. It sits where the Gulf of Mexico meets the mouth of the Mississippi River. You got all kind of Americans coming down the Mississippi. It's central to the slave trade. You have all types of slaves. You have all kind of people coming from the second largest port in the United States of America. It's also more integrated than any other city in the South, in America, because the people all live close to each other. It's below sea level. The air is heavy, okay? All of that is happening in one place, and it's not a big place.
African Americans added three fresh strains to the city's already rich musical mix. Ragtime was first heard in black neighborhoods in Midwestern cities, syncopating and rearranging every kind of music to create livelier, more danceable versions. At about the same time, black refugees from the cotton fields of the Mississippi River Delta began streaming into the city. With them, they brought the blues, the musical style that reflected the trials and joys of everyday life. Then there was church music, similar to the blues, trying to find hope in a troubled world. Each was built around the same rhythms, the same moans and cries and bent notes. New Orleans cornet king Buddy Bolden was the first to understand that wonderful things would happen if you brought together the sounds of a marching band and the emotional power of the blues. Buddy delivered an enormously original sound using an inventiveness that had people flocking to see him.
He's from the church, so you can hear the sound of all the people shouting in the church. He knows the blues, so he sounds like a blues player. He's been playing dances and quadrilles and all these things, so he knows kind of the French music. He knows kind of arias and pieces, marching band tradition. He can play like that. He has the kind of feeling of the dances in the lowest form of clubs. And he's a virtuoso on his horn. Well, this person puts all of these things together and starts to improvise and make up his part. He doesn't want to read the music, he goes off the music. And when he starts to go off of the music, he's creating music that sounds like all of that music. That's what jazz is. Louis Armstrong taught people how to be modern because he was so supremely confident in his genius that he could be all the things at once. He could be a fool, he could be a genius, he could be the most sacred. He sang spirituals, he sang the dirtiest, most low-down blueses, he played the trumpet in a way that no one has ever played it. He played the most beautiful, pristine melodies, he sang romantic songs, he created masterpieces, he did everything you could possibly do.
Louis Armstrong, raised in a poor New Orleans neighborhood, became not only a legendary jazz musician, but a legendary American.
I don't think that there has been a person in music like that, like him. And he is the embodiment of jazz.
Segregation may have governed even the smallest details of daily life, but it would never be able to keep real musicians from listening to and learning from one another in New Orleans or anywhere else.
The reason that there's always been a question of jazz is because of race. And that's why it is jazz, because jazz came to tell you the race is not the issue. The issue is, what does it mean to be an American? And if anybody can be one, if they are one.
So, that's a little introduction to how jazz got to be where it was. We're going to look at some great photos here as well, just so kind of bear with me here. Photos of the time. And once again, here's New Orleans. Here's that port. Here's that where things were happening. Mardi Gras. It's a little different back then than it is today, but kind of the same idea. Here's an opera house. Creole musician. Remember, Creole is kind of French and African. And, you know, this was not a very good time for race back in those days. And even though they were French, they were thought of as second-class citizens as well as American, African-Americans. Jim Crow laws, you were not allowed to be on the same train car. You couldn't, they were segregated train cars. So you had train cars for whites and train cars for blacks. Here's an old country church, Louisiana. Once again, there's Buddy Bolden. Jelly Roll Morton, great piano player of this early time. Spent a lot of his time in Chicago. Entertainment, vaudeville, blackface, really popular back then, would not go well today. Another Chicago. So it goes from New Orleans to Chicago pretty quick. Not that it ever leaves New Orleans, but it just kind of migrated up the Mississippi River. There's an original Creole orchestra. And there's your first Dixieland jazz band. This is vinyl. This is how you used to play records. They would come in squares and you could put them in papers and magazines. Yeah, quite different than what we use today. Dance records. These were things, jazz was definitely something that you would dance to. More artists we're looking at. Here's your military band. Here's one of your old brass bands. That's kind of where Dixieland came from, the marching bands. This would be an old example of a marching and or military band. Then you just put the blues to it and you've got Dixie, Sidney Bechet. Nice outfits. I was thinking maybe we would wear something like this next year. We'll see how that goes. And then here's, yeah, Bix Beiderbecke. I think we played some in class earlier this year. He was kind of one of the first rock stars of jazz back then. Once again, you know, as blacks, you would probably want to go up to Chicago to be free. And that was and they brought the music with them. So that was a natural migration. State Street in Chicago, 1920. That, if you've been there, you know this has changed a bunch. But this is what it looked like back in 1920. Once again, there's your bands. There's Louis Armstrong and his mom and sister. That's a pretty cool picture. Early Louis Armstrong. Now they're on steamboats. This is your cruise ships. They were steamboats back then, and they would hire bands to play, to entertain. And there's Louis and Joe King Oliver on his left, your right. So a couple of the big hitters from back in the day. Another picture of Louis. Pretty reserved. Most of the pictures we know of Louis are pretty more entertaining. There's your cruise ship. Coronavirus would go mad on a ship like that. And Fletcher Henderson. Yeah, another big time cat back then. And here's Harlem. So New York City, another hub, major city. The jazz clubs would open up in Harlem back in the 20s as well. And that's kind of a look at what the scenes were. As far as listening to this music, you heard some of it through the video. I've got a couple more examples for you to play. Let's see here. Kind of give you a feeling back then. Here's the Eureka Brass Band playing Whoopin' Blues. Of course, you've got Ragtime, Scott Joplin. This is Maple Leaf Rag. Got a little Jelly Roll Morton here, Black Bottom Stomp. King Oliver, the Snake Rag. Here's features Sidney Bechet, Cakewalking Babies from Home. Louis Armstrong, this is West End Blues. You know, as a trumpet player learning how to improvise, Louis Armstrong is a great place to start. If you want to learn how to play melodically, lyrically, he really had that down. Armstrong, Lazy River.
Blue skies up above, everyone in love, off the Lazy River.
It's got that distinct voice that you all know very well. Wonderful World, you know that. Louis was a true entertainer, not only his trumpet playing and his singing, and really fit in with the probably questionable entertainment back in that day, but that's just what it was. It wasn't always pretty, but he was certainly a big part of rap and maybe the first hip-hop, you know? So anyways, that's Dixieland and Ragtime. So your assignment for this week is to find something. Find a Dixie piece or a Ragtime piece and fill out a music analysis worksheet, which will be attached to the assignment. Once again, I'm going to attach it as a Word file and a PDF file, and make sure you really work on making sure that your work gets saved to either format, and make sure it gets uploaded to Blackboard, and enjoy the old jazz, and we'll talk to you in a week. Have a great week.
We got that reservoir.